Good afternoon, everyone, and thank you all for coming. Today I'm going to present my thesis on master project. It's called the indentation size effects in dental structures, a microindentation approach. It was a research developed with the professor Uriel Zapata and me, Carlos Urrego. Now I'm going to make a brief description of my profile. Who I am? I'm a mechanical engineer from the university. I'm currently finishing my master in engineering. I'm focusing on the material design, that is the emphasis line of the career. And I had experiences. I finished my undergrad in mechanical design consulting and scientific research. This is my contact, if anyone needs to reach out. Now, the introduction. The understanding of the mechanical behavior of the dental materials has been widely acknowledged for dental practitioners, medical practitioners, and for material researchers. Why? First, it's a billion dollars wealth in trends yearly, and the tooth is a biological marvel. Why? If we see it as a design, as a mechanical component, the teeth undergo million cycles of loads yearly. There are some reports that say that you can chew up to 1 million times yearly if we escalate that in your life. That's like big time loads. This is under an aggressive environment. We have saliva, we drink alcohol, we have alkaline and high pH drinks in our mouth, so it's constantly changing. Also, we have thermal cycles of stress. We can eat cold drinks up to -4, -6 Celsius degrees, and then drink something hot between 60, 70 degrees, so that makes a delta pretty high. Now, it has a unique mechanical behavior. We have two macro layers. Those are the enamel and the emptying. I'm going to explain it later. But those are composed by the same proteins, same substance, same organic matrix, and the difference is the ratios of the composition. And this is what exerts like a big macro different behavior. It's also a high durability system. It's up to 90, 80 years working on these specific scenarios and has a lot of absorption mechanisms. It's a structure developed for absorption of energy. Now, this is the tooth structure. So, on your right, you see this is the gum, and if we draw a line, a parallel line, everything above it is the crown, and everything below is the root. Now, the outer layer is the enamel. For some animals, it's called enameloid. The thing is the difference how it's composed. If the mineral phase is composed by hydroxyapatite, it's enamel. If it's fluorapatite, it's enameloid. Basically, in fishes, we have enameloid. And in mammals and reptiles, we have enamel. And the dentin, that is the inner layer, that it's just between the pulp cavity and the enamel, that it's a thicker tissue with less mineral content. Now, this pulp cavity is where the nerve is in. This is the conduct to the bone. Now, we are going to analyze the two biggest layers, the enamel and the dentin, or enameloid for the case of fish. Now, we wanted to understand the mechanical behavior. The mechanical behavior can be represented by hardness. What is hardness? It's a surface property that tells us how a material is resisting to be penetrated by another one. Basically, this can correlate the wear resistance, the elastic modulus, and the fracture toughness of a material. Now, for putting in an example, if we take four blocks of material, different materials, and take a nail and a hammer, make it the same tip and the same force in the hammer. If we just hit every block, and this is the wood, we're going to have high penetration. Here in the high density polyethylene, a polymer, it's going to be less, but it's still significant. Then, if we take an aluminum block, it's going to be not that much as HDPE, but it's going to be some penetration. Now, if we take an alloy steel or some thermal treatment, it's going to be way harder, this one. So that's basically how it works. Now, this tip depends, and there's standards. There's basically two for the procedures that we're doing, the Berkovich and the Vickers. Both are like kind of for the same. The difference is that the three-sided pyramid and four-sided pyramid, those are the standard, usually made out of diamond. And this This Vickers tip is the one that we use because it's less sensitive to surface roughness, to flatness, and inclination of the layers. So that's what we used. It's for like shielding the procedure. Now, how hardness is characterized? Basically, that's the material, okay? And we have an indenter, the tip that we said. Then, if we apply a load in the indenter, it's going to go and press the material. We'll have a waiting time, something for the impression to be in the material. That's called the dwell time. Then, that's another variable, okay? We have load, tip, and dwell. After we have this one, we remove the load, and we have a print. If we measure both diagonals and operate with this formula, or it may vary a bit depending on the units, we're going to have the hardness in units of pascals, okay? It's a relation between the force applied and the area. Now, what happened? If we're going to compare hardness values, we need to have the same load, the same tip, and the same dwell time. So, hence, we have all those variables. If we do not have the same for two materials, we cannot compare the values. Now, what is the standard saying? If you're going to characterize a material in hardness, you have to create the whole characterization with loads. So you start with smaller loads and end up with the maximum load. The maximum load for microindentation is 1 kilogram, and the lowest is 10 grams. Okay? When you analyze all of this, you're going to have a curved region. This region obeys to a phenomenon called as indentation size effect. That it's basically that the material, due to the elastic recovery and the small amount of energy applied, it's going to recover in such way that it's not homogeneous. So that is a threat, because we have a property that it's depending on the measuring process. So what do we have to do? Cover all the loads, and then when we find the plateau, that it's when it's stabilized, we create the boundary, and we can evaluate in all the loads that we have here. What happened? If we have a load too way on the right, that's a lot of energy. And up to this point, we already know the hardness. But if we start increasing the energy in the system, the thing is that we start dissipating the energy applied by cracks propagation. That, by means of lab test, we're going to start damaging our material. Now, what happened in the literature? Basically, these are the dental hardness authors that have been working with the related topics. And the D obey for dentin and the E for enamel. They start in 1985 with 0.98. Then we have in the middle of 2005, 9.8 newtons. And then they all the way back and in 2. So it's funny because it's dentin, we have 0.98. Then we have 2.45. So those are like not comparable. And here we have the same values, but this author used for dentin and the other one for enamel. So wait, none of this evaluated the whole curve. They did not assess the behavior of the material. So basically, our motivation is what? The standardization of the procedures when evaluating materials are going to set a stronger basis for the development of materials for restorative dentin, dentistry. Now, the problem statement. The lack of standardizations of procedure and the fact that they're not taking into account the indentation size effect precludes the comparison between studies when doing dental research. So our objective is to determine the adequate indentation load for characterizing dental materials under the hypothesis that exists an indentation load for each animal that can be used for assessing all dentin, enamel without crack propagation. This crack propagation is because we have small samples, we're working with teeth. We have no unlimited space, and we have constraints in the dimensions that I'm going to mention later. Now, how did we assess this? Basically, in a nutshell, what we did was we worked with the three type of animal kingdoms that we have with teeth. It's mammal with pigs or swine, fish with a kind of fish and a species called payara, and a reptile, the alligator. Then we used the human specimens for comparing with the human samples. Then we evaluated the dentin and the enamel in the cases that we had more than 200 microns of thickness for enamel, and then dentin just for the small samples with the small thickness. Then we performed the microindentation hardness test, then start increasing the load for creating the chart, then we plotted the indentation size effect chart and analyzed the data for then analyzing the results. Those are the specimens. This is the jaw of the pig. This is the alligator jaw, and this is the pajara fish. Okay. So the sample preparation, since the teeth is not easy to work with geometry, we had to embed it so we can have fixed geometry with that we can guarantee surface flatness for working. So we took 2 molars out of each sample, then we cut it with a diamond saw, then we embed it in a cold cure epoxy resin, and after embedding the halves, we polished it and ultrasonically cleaned so we can evaluate this surface. Okay? Since we have this surface parallel to the bases, we can evaluate all the teeth. Now, for guaranteeing that the organic matrix that it's made, the teeth, we had to have it immersed in fluids that will able to keep the in vitro study, keeping the tissue alive to resemble the natural conditions and to freeze it at 2 Celsius degrees, because that slows down the rate of organic matrix loss. So you can see it better. These are the physical specimen, cut it in halves and embedded in cold cured epoxy. So in green convention, we have crocodile, red for pig, and blue for human. After we had this, we used a small steel plate where we fixed the sample and we put it into the indenter, is this one. And this is then the knob that we had, that it goes from 10 grams force to 1,000 grams force. That's the whole range of loads that we used. Every single step was determined by the equipment, and we start assessing every load in these samples. Now, where? These are actual photos of the teeth cut in half. The convention of names is basically M1 obey to sample 1, and DP, dentin pathway, EP, enamel pathway, and 1 and 2 and 3, the number of the path. These are the 2 porcine samples. So we start covering the whole section in dentin, the whole section in enamel, with 3 pathways. Okay, in total, there with this teeth and the human teeth and fish teeth and alligator teeth, fish is still on course, we have more than 300 indentations so far. We worked with 2 standards. The first one is how to evaluate the hardness by the ASTM, and there it has a subindex that is the E384, is how to evaluate advanced ceramics, advanced as these kind of tissues. Now, so you can see this is an indentation, an actual indentation. These are 3 photos that I took from the project. These are from human samples. So this is in a load of 300. This is for 500 grams force, and here for 1,000. The size start increasing, but the hardness value, you'll see that it's almost the same because it is a ratio between the load and the diagonals. Here we have 90 microns, and here we have 163. So that's how it is increased. Now, this is part of the design of the experiments that it's like a aggregate value for us. We used a group, this is an example with the porcine samples, of how to prove that the indentation size effect exists. So we took the groups for loads and we start organizing the data. Then we used an ANOVA analysis, and it showed, okay, you have a p-value lower than your required, that it was 0.05, and it showed that, yeah, it's something like you wanted, it exists, okay? But then we said, okay, the authors analyzed it, And they say that it stabilizes around here. The last two authors, they said 1.96 newtons. That obeyed to 200 grand force. So they said that the plateau was reached here. But if you just said it because you watch it, that's a giant bias threat. So if we proved that all these groups were statistically different, what we said was if we start reducing the number of groups going near the plateau, when we found that these groups are statistically not different, this is when you reach the plateau. Here is when we found that it's not at 200 for porcine instead of 300 for pigs. And we applied all of these for all the samples. And here we can see that for human, it was reached at 500. So we can evaluate in all this area. And here in 300, so we can evaluate all this area. And if we just overlap the two charts, we have a gap being harder than human tissue. It's not, was kind of unexpected for us. Then we went to dentin, and we saw that for human and for pigs, it was so stable. Just the first two loads, 10 grams and 25 grams, were like jumping, but then at 50, it stabilizes completely. We have a lot of data, a lot of groups that were statistically the same, were considered within the same range. But then alligator exhibited a different trend and showed different and a different boundary. Here we have the boundary of indentation size effect in human and pig in 50, and here in 500. Giving us a smaller area of work for the alligator samples. Now, if we organize the results, having the label convention for human being blue, pig being orange, alligator being green, and above this dotted line, enamel, and under this one, dentin, we see that human and pig has almost the same trend with a gap, being the human tissue harder than the porcine. Now, the discussions. Why? We first saw that for enamel, we needed more than 500 grams for human and 300 or more grams for pig. Whilst in dentin, we can use 50 grams for human and porcines and 500 for alligator. Now, if we see this, I compared it with the references, and the ones in red are completely out of the region. And these two in orange, they're so in the right. They're using almost 10, 20 times more load that they needed, so they're creating massive crack propagations. And if we see, sorry if I go back, I wanted to show you, if we see that if we need to measure this with high sensibility, when you have big, massive cracks going out of the corners, what you're going to have is bigger error when you're measuring it and damage in your sample. Now, basically explaining the organic matrix contribution, it's that we have two layers, enamel and dentin. Both are composed by a mineral phase and organic phase. The mineral, it's composed by hydroxyapatite in mammals and reptile and fluorapatite in fish. And the organic, that are proteins and water. These two elements joined together in different ratios are going to give us the enamel and the dentin. And simple as this is 95 and 5 and this is 45 and 55, we can have a tissue that here it's 6, 10 times harder than this one. And, well, why? Basically, if we see this as a whole system composed by two elements working and interacting together, we have that the enamel has a cover, is the cover, is protecting. This is the one that it's carrying the direct load and it's giving the high wear resistance, the geometry stiffness, and it's a sieve for transport because this is going to be fitted from the inside but needs to protect from the outside and also acts like a seal for threats. Now, the dentin gives high energy absorption, crack dissipation. It's a permeable tissue that allows to send nutrients to the enamel, and also it's it's tougher. Now, if we unfold the specimen characteristics for humans, the life expectancy is the highest, almost 80 years. For alligators, 40, the second, and for pigs, 17 years. We start pulling out all the variables that we thought that may be of interest in when you're designing. This is almost a requirement. We have diphodont. These are polyphodont. What does this mean? We have two teeth. That's it. We have a deciduous and permanent. You lose your deciduous up to when you're 7, and then you're on your own. You have to be at least 70, 80 years with the thing that you had. These guys can change it every time they lose it. They have the other teeth attached right beneath the other one. So if they lose this one is still alive. Now, the bite force, human, it's 700 newtons. Pig, almost half, more than half. And alligators, 16,400 newtons. That's more than 10 times this one. So, if we say, okay, now, how do they work? I mean, we have incisive, we have canine, we have molars, we have premolars, and the same with pigs, but the alligators all are the same. We have heterodont, they're a homodont. We have a lot of differences. But well, if you assume it, okay, what are they using it for? We need to mastication, we're chewing our food. First we tear it, and then we process it, and they just rip and kill. That's it. So if we associate this one, we are differentiating this so can last this time, undergo this force, and work for this, while these guys are doing that. So the requirement is that they need something that lasts lots of time, while these ones need to undergo a lot of energy to stand that. So as a result, what was it? We only have one teeth for 70 years. We have a strong one. They have a lot. They can replace it. They just need samples that stand. One bite, one kill, and there you go. That's it. Now, our concluding remarks of the research was the first one, the tissue for its structure, its complexity, requires full characterization. We have fluctuations between the hardness values and the loads. Also, there's a contribution with the way that we determine the hardness plateau, statistically, removing the bias. Not saying, okay, I think that it's stable from this point and beyond. No. And that to determine the adequate indentation load, it's always mandatory if you're going to evaluate a dental tissue. Now, last, and it's like for further research, the analysis of function, form, and properties, it cannot be attached. We're talking about that these shapes are the result of a long, long evolutionary process. That being all, thank you.